Okay, good morning, everybody. Welcome to St. Matthew's for Sunday worship. We are thrilled to have you with us. Come on in and have a seat. A special hello to all of our friends who are joining us online. Today is the first day of official Christmas pageant rehearsal. So if your children are here to participate in the Christmas pageant, we actually invite them right now to go back into the parish hall, into classrooms 1 and 2, where pageant rehearsal is getting started. And boy, we can't wait to have our Christmas pageant on Christmas Eve. We're really looking forward to that. So we're thrilled that you're with us today. Today is the first Sunday of Advent, and we are going to celebrate by starting the service with the lighting of our Advent wreath. So let's go ahead and get things started.
Today we will light the candle. Today we will light the first candle of the Advent wreath. The candle we will light today reminds us of God's grace.
A reading from John chapter 1, verse 16. From God's fullness, we have all received grace upon grace. Let us pray. Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Now, in the time of this mortal life in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to visit us in great humility, that in the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge both the living and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal. Through him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you. Nicely done. Light and peace in Jesus Christ our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The shepherds came to see the baby, stood by his mother's side. He lay the Savior inside a manger. Oh, what a glorious night. Oh, what a glorious night. I hear the angels sing, hallelujah, let the earth receive her. They come. All is calm now. All is quiet. A star shining in the sky. Below in Bethlehem, the king is sleeping. Oh, what a glorious night. Oh, what a glorious night. One star burns in the darkness, shines with the promise, Emmanuel. One child born in the stillness, living within us, Emmanuel. We're singing glory. Start with me. One voice speaks for the voiceless, hope with the hopeless, Emmanuel. One love brings us together, now and forever, Emmanuel. We're singing. Nothing stands in the way. His love is strong enough to lead us. Do not be afraid. His love is strong enough to save us. Nothing stands in his way. We're singing glory, glory, let there be peace, let it start with me. We're singing glory, glory, let there be peace, let there be peace. We're singing glory, glory, let there be peace, let it start with me. Let there be peace, let it start with me.
Peace, let it start with me. That's next week. So you want to be here next week when we talk about that. Our gospel today comes from Mark. This is Advent Sunday. We just changed colors. So Advent is the first Sunday in the church year, or the first day of the church year. So a new year. And so we've been reading from the Gospel of Matthew. Today we move to the Gospel of Mark. And there we read, Jesus said, "In those days after that suffering, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. And the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he'll send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near at the very gates. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It's like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. Let us pray. Oh Lord, may your words only be heard, spoken and your words only heard, and we do ask this all for your love's precious sake. Amen. Please be seated. Well, it is so good to see all of you on this dreary day, and it's not dreary at all in here, seeing your warm and smiling faces. So what a beautiful, beautiful thing. Every week in the Episcopal Church, there's three readings. There's an Old Testament reading, a psalm, a New Testament reading, and a gospel. At this service, we only read the gospel to give a certain focus, and this service has a lot of young children. Their attention span isn't often as long, and so we just wanted to really kind of pare it down. And when we originally started this service, we were squeezing it in between a bunch of different services, and we only had 55 minutes. We just had to keep it short. So all that went into the decision. But if we'd read the epistle today, that's a fancy word for letter, that's the second reading, it would have started, "Grace and peace to you through God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ." It's written by a man named Paul. Paul was an apostle, he was one of the founding fathers in the early church. And so because he couldn't always get around, they weren't able to get around as much back then, he wrote letters to facilitate communications between himself and the various churches, and those letters are preserved for us in the Bible. And so one of these letters is a letter written to the church in Corinthians, entitled, appropriately enough, 1 Corinthians. We think there's actually four of those letters, two survive, and the second one is called 2 Corinthians. Paul always starts all of his letters off in the exact same way: grace and peace to you. And we're going to pick up peace next week. Again, there's no peace out there until we find peace in here. And so if you feel like you could use a little bit more peace or some tips as to how to spread calm, that's next week. We hope you'll join us for that. But today we want to focus on the grace part of that. Grace and peace to you. And then Paul always ends his letters with the same thing: grace to you. It might not be the very last line, but like in the last five lines of the letter, there'll always be this line: grace to you. And if you want to have some fun, and I did this a couple weeks ago just preparing for the sermon, open up your Bible, look at the letters Paul wrote, start with the letter to the church in Rome called Romans, then there's 1st and 2nd Corinthians, then Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1st and 2nd Timothy, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, and Titus. Those will be the letters of Paul. And just read the first couple sentences. You always see in there, grace and peace to you. And then flip over to the last chapter, read maybe like the last five or six sentences, and you always see grace to you. Because that's for Paul, everything started and ended with grace. Because, in fact, that's what Christianity is all about, is grace. And if we go back to the Gospels, the first books of the New Testament, in the Gospel of John, we're told that the law came through Moses, but grace came through Jesus Christ. Now, the law was a great gift. The human race was in need of law. When we started off, we were just glorified animals, and so we needed the law to regulate our lives and to limit our hostilities towards each other. So the law was a great gift, a beautiful thing, and it's something always to be celebrated and treasured and appreciated. But human beings at their best aren't people who are sticking to the law. We're people who, the law orders our life and guides our life, and it's super helpful that way, but we also know how to extend grace to one another above and beyond the law. And so we're told that the gift that Moses gave us, and it was a great gift, was the law. The gift that Jesus brings to us is grace. And John will go on to say that God in Jesus gave us grace upon grace. So in this day, when we see something of how hostile religions can be, and we look at, and in so many people's eyes, the recent days only highlight the negative aspect of religion. I just want to say as plain can be, from start to finish, what Christianity, the vision of Jesus and the vision of the early founders of the church, their vision for Christianity was that it would be a religion from start to finish, literally, a religion of grace. that it would be a lifestyle that was marked by nothing so much as by grace. And, you know, what does that mean? Does that mean we all say everybody sort of believes the same thing? No, we don't. Religions aren't all different roads up the same mountain. Anybody who takes religion seriously knows that's not the case, and people who adhere closely to religions would be deeply offended if you went up to a devout Muslim and said, yeah, you know, or a devout Christian or a devout Jew or anything and say, yeah, your religion is really just the same as everybody else's. We, in fact, would be offended by that because we know they're not the same. We teach some things that are very similar. We teach some things that are very, very different. To be gracious means that we're not going to shove those truths down people's throats. That's not what Christianity is meant to be about, shoving truth down a person's throat. But it's meant to be that we're going to be gracious. And in light of those differences, understanding those differences, recognizing those differences, we're still going to be respectful of each other, fully appreciate and guard in every way we can one another's rights, and just be kind to each other. That's grace. That's the hallmark of Christianity. Not trying to shove truth down people's throats, trying to force people into some sort of path or something like that, but being so gracious that people say, man, whatever it is that they believe, I want some of that. I want more of that. That's meant to be the hallmark of Christianity. So start to finish, all about grace. And if it's not about grace, we're missing something somewhere along the line. All right? Just plain and simple. Now, the big question becomes then, how do we show grace? If Christianity meant from start to finish is really meant to be about grace, then how do we show grace to a world sorely in need of grace? And there's lots of answers to that. So today we're gonna hone in on one. And that is one way to be gracious and to help make the world more gracious is simply to believe the best of each other and to treat each other accordingly. Now the interesting thing is that human beings sort of by nature already pretty much believe the best of ourselves, right? We tend to see each ourselves as better than we really are. That seems to be a mark of human nature. Men a little bit more than women, okay? But we won't get into that today. But this has been proven by a recent study. I read this just a couple weeks ago and was utterly fascinated by it. And then in this study, what they did was they brought people into a lab, then they took a picture of the person, and then when the person left, and then they were told they'd have to come back in 2 weeks and pick the picture that was really of them. And so people took the picture and then they used filters. Anybody know what filters are? Yeah, okay, so filters are those things on our cameras that make us look better than we really are, right? And so they took filters and they made the person look more handsome than they really are. So like they would take my picture and then Brian or Greg, they would make me look a little more like Greg or Brian so that I'd be more handsome than I really am. And then they would also pick somebody, I don't know who that might be because there aren't many people, who are actually uglier than I am, and then they would make my picture look a little bit like that person as well, okay? And then, if they really did it, they would make me, well, they might make me look like Brian or Greg because they really are handsome men, but they would take somebody like Brad Pitt and they'd make me look a little bit more like Brad Pitt. And then if they wanted to make me look like somebody else, a little bit uglier, I mean, even though my wife really likes him and thinks that he's sort of like the most handsome guy of all, I've always thought Tom Cruise is a little physically lacking. He's got these squinty little eyes. So they'd make me look like Tom Cruise, okay? So that's what they would do. And then 2 weeks after that, people would come back into the lab and they would put these pictures out there and they'd have the range and they would say, pick the one that's really you, that is the accurate picture of you. And guess which one people pick? The one that's improved. The filtered picture, Brad Pitt, that's exactly right. Brad Pitt, or Brian, or Greg, as the case may be. And so, and you know what, we know that's true. There's an even more common sense sort of application of that, and that is, that's why we hate other people's pictures of us. We see other people's pictures of us, and we say, that we don't look like that. That's not how we look. That's an awful picture of me. Don't show anybody that, right? Isn't that what we say? But that's exactly how we look. In most pictures, what we do is, we get just the right angle. I mean, you know that when I was younger, I was a bodybuilder, and Arnold Schwarzenegger, who was like the premier bodybuilder of that day and age, he had wide hip structure, even though he had super wide shoulders, and so he said, you know, it's all an illusion to make your shoulders look so much wider than, so he said, you always stand at an angle so that your hips are angled slightly, and then when you go like this, you'll look, you know, you'll look at, so it's, so we angle ourselves in certain ways, all right? We angle ourselves in certain ways so that we look better than, you know, so then we, then, so that was a weird pose. That was always a weird pose, you know, that one, but I'm blushing, sorry. We angle ourselves in better ways. There's this trick I think that women do where they sort of stretch their necks out and hold their breath so that their necks looks, I never quite understood that or whatever, but anyhow, so these are the pictures we think that's how we look, but that's actually not how we look. How we look are candid pictures. So we want to think that we are, and this applies a whole bunch of other, we want to think that we're better than we really are. But the problem is when we look at other people, we think that other people aren't as good as we are or even as good as they are. And so we tend to believe the worst of other people. This is called, you've heard of this before, Dave could tell us this from his studies at Stanford and other places, the fundamental attribution error. Dave, what's the fundamental attribution error? It's hard to remember this morning, and all that says, I get it, yes, all right. So I apologize for putting you on the spot like that. Fundamental attribution error is when we, whenever we see somebody make a mistake, do something wrong, have some fault or flailing, we think it's a character defect. So Dave couldn't remember this morning, so, and you can see we had this all set up ahead of time, it must be because Dave isn't as smart as I am, all right, that Dave has some, but if Dave asked me what the fundamental attribution error, and I hadn't studied up for it, and I said, oh, I don't know, I would say, well, how would you expect me to remember? It's first thing in the morning, I'm still asleep, I'm not awake, I would make all kind of excuses for myself. So for Dave, I'd see it as a character flaw. For me, I'd say, ah, it's just, you know, it was unreasonable, but it was expected of me anyhow. Wouldn't give anybody else a break, but I give myself a break. That's the fundamental attribution error. We tend to believe the best of ourselves and not maybe the best of other people. But what Christianity has always said, and it's always said that grace starts with God. It starts, and so we get grace from God, and then getting grace from God, it changes us, and then we give that grace to other people. And one of the ways that God extends grace to us is God sees us, God sees you, God sees me as better than we really are. And there's this old saying, and you've probably heard it before, God loves us exactly the way we are, but he loves us too much to leave us that way. And there's so much hope for me in that. I mean, for me, like, the worst thing of all things would be to left to be exactly the way I am. I have lots of good points, I think, but I've still got some things I'm working on. To think that I would always be stuck in the things I don't get right would be very sad to me. So the hope that God is still at work helping me to be the person that I want to be and might yet be, that's just such a great source of encouragement and comfort. So God extends us grace that God doesn't treat us like we are. God's always reaching out and seeing in us the very best we can be and calling us and coaching us and helping us and gifting us to become that person. And so to extend grace to other people is to extend what God extends to us and what we extend to ourselves. And it's to see give other people the benefit of the doubt. To see other people as better than they might actually be. So that how they are doesn't actually make any difference as to how we treat them. Right? They really might be something of a pill. But we don't see them as that. We give them the benefit of the doubt. We find a way to see them in a better light, to reframe things, and then we treat them accordingly. That, my friends, is grace. There is a man by the name of Neil Ford, and it's worth writing this guy's name down. Neil, N-E-I-L, and then Ford, F-O-A-R-D. All right, so it's that's how his last name is spelled. He's got a YouTube channel, and his videos are just like maybe 2 minutes long. And I personally think that Neil Ford is the best storyteller alive on the face of this planet right now. Neil Ford is just a master storyteller. And in fact, we have studied Neil Ford and trying to become better storytellers ourselves. And he's in the story that sort of launched him was a little vignette called A Postcard from 1969. And all the stories are true, and which makes them all the more incredible. And this is that story. This was 1969, a tough year in the life of America. All kinds of things were coming apart at the seams, and people had just been shot, like the president, and you know, there were all kinds of riots and just all kinds of stuff. It was, you know, not maybe our best year in America. All kinds of protests, and they were traveling out west. I don't remember where, and their car broke down out in the middle of nowhere, outside some tiny little pohunk town. And his dad popped the hood and saw it was the water pump. The water pump wasn't working in the car, so the car wasn't going to run. And in those days, and this will be a shock to anybody under 35, They did not have cell phones, okay? They didn't have, so, you know, they, believe it or not, there was a day and age where we did not have cell phones. All we had were something called landlines, all right? If you don't know what a landline is, your parents will explain it to you afterwards. But you couldn't carry them around with you. So all we had were landlines. And so if you were in the middle of nowhere and your car broke down, you were stuck. I mean, that was all there is to it. You were stuck. One of two things were going to happen. You were going to walk the 10 miles into town, right? Or hitchhike. I mean, we did that back then. And someone in out of the good of their heart was going to have to drive by and pick you up and take you into town. Those are your only alternatives. And so what this would likely mean is that this father and son were going to sit in the car until somebody drove by, which might be days, and let them. But it just so happened that a cowboy drove by in a flatbed truck, and he saw them broken down along the side of the road, so he pulled his truck over, and he said, as people did back then, he said, "Hey, neighbor, looks like you're having some difficulty. Could I help you with that?" And Neil Ford said, "My dad kind of stiffened up a little bit because he didn't have enough money to pay. He said all he had was a Chevron credit card, actually. And he didn't have, and so he said, "Well, I don't have any money to pay you, so I mean, I don't know how you're going to help." And the guy said, "Well, don't worry about that. We'll figure it out. Looks like you and your boy need some help there, so let's get your car up on the truck. We'll take it into town, see what we can do." Dad doesn't really have any other choice, so he goes along with it. So they put the car up on the flatbed truck. They take it into town. And they get in town, and the guy driving the truck says, "Well, oh, I forgot the shop isn't open, so we're going to have to go find the mechanic." Because it's a little town. Everybody knows everybody, knows where the mechanic lives. They drive up to the mechanic house, knock. Well, I guess they offload the car at the guy's shop. Then they go find the house, knock on the door, and the guy says, "Oh, yeah, sure. I see we've got a father and a son out there, and they need some help. Now, let's see what I can do." So he goes in. They pull the car into the shop. The guy looks at it, and he says, "Oh, yeah, it's the water pump." He said, "But I don't have any of those in stock. We got to go find the parts dealer." So they get in the car again. They go find the parts dealer. Says, "Hey, we got this father and son. They're stuck, and I can fix the car, but I don't have the part. Do you happen to have it on you?" And the guy says, "Oh yeah, sure. Let me look." He goes, looks on the shelf. He says, "Yeah, here's the part." They get the part, and now the dad's getting super uncomfortable because there's all these people helping, and they're helping on their day off, and he realizes that time is money, and he says again, "Look," he says, I don't have any way to pay you, and I'm just not comfortable with this." And the guy, the original cowboy, says, "Don't worry, we'll figure something out. Let's just see what we can do here." So they get the car back in the shop, and the mechanic starts to fix it. And the cowboy says, "You know what? I thought of something. I thought how you can help me." He says, "I have another truck full of watermelons over here that need to be loaded on this car on a train. And if you help me offload all these watermelons off my truck into this train, we'll call it even." So the dad says, "Well, okay, that sounds like a good deal. I think we can do that." So he gets out of the car, and with his son, they start, moving watermelons. I don't know what the right word for that is. They start moving watermelons. And it says, and Neil says, it's like 140 degrees in the train car. They're just dripped with sweat. But when it's all said and done, they're just finishing up, and the mechanic pulls up, and the car's running like a top. And then he says, "Here's your car. Everything's good." And the dad's relieved, and they get in the car, and they're about to drive away. And then the cowboy says, "Hey, where do you think you're going?" And now Neil looks at his dad, and he said, "My dad, he just stiffens all up again." He says, just like a stiff leopard. And you can see all the fear and distrust coming up into his face as he thinks these people are now going to say, "Okay, you need to give us something for this." And his dad's just almost starting to shake, and the guy says, "You need to come join us for dinner. Where do you think you're going? You need to come have dinner with us. I mean, we got a big family meal out on the table over there. Come back to the house, get a shower, cleaned up, have a meal. You'll drive a lot better if you just have dinner with us." And the guy starts to say, "No, no, no." He says, "Oh, no, come on, come on, come on." And so they end back up at the house. And he talks about this big Sunday meal that the community was having. And he said, I've never had such a good meal since. And he said they drove away from this dinner. And he said the whole way home, my dad didn't say three words. He said, you could just see him processing all this. And then he said, but when I was going to sleep at night, and here he starts to tear up. He said, my dad knocked on the door and stuck his head in the room and said, "Son, I don't care what you've read on the news, what you've heard on the news, read in the newspapers, or seen on the movies, that's how people are." then he shut the door and walked out. And Neil Ford says, a month later, Neil Armstrong walked on the moon. Keep the faith. That's what it means to extend grace to one another. To see what we could be and someday might yet become. And treat each other accordingly. To treat each other with kindness and grace. By God's grace, with God's help, may it be so. Amen. Back down. Thank you, Cindy. See me as better than I really am, please. I could use all the help I can get. So the way we wanted to end that is we know that the holiday season is a busy season and that everybody starts to get amped up and worked up. And so we wanted to give a moment just to relax and hear what's really a sweet song and just sort of let the song wash over us and find a space where we can appreciate the sweetness of life, the goodness of life, and then extend that sweetness and go out from here better prepared to extend that sweetness and grace to each other. All right, so.
And also in that grace of God, we are always reminded that we have a purpose. This song's about that.
Hey moon. It's funny how time just flies. Yesterday, we were just kids hanging in the sky, staying up all night. Hey moon, do you ever get a tear in your eye when you think about the time that God came down? I couldn't help myself, had to shine so bright. I remember that newborn baby and the wise man that traveled so far. That's when I knew I was made for a reason. I feel like the luckiest star. Hey, have changed. I wish that they could see the things we've seen before, the colored lights and the Christmas trees. Hey moon, so many are still searching for signs, but God is stirring in their hearts. They will lift their wandering eyes and see her shine. Then they'll remember that newborn baby and the wise men that traveled so far. They'll know that they were made for a reason. I feel like the luckiest star. Hey, traveled so far. I know that I was made for a reason. I feel like the luckiest star. Hey, moon. Hey, moon. Hey, moon. Hey, moon. Hey, moon.
To the God who gives us grace and peace, we pray. Give the church the heart to give away breathtaking amounts. Lead our leaders to grace.
Help us all to be rulers of each other, to be kinder, especially in public discourse.
Create communities so filled with grace that we don't need to use filters to make ourselves look better than we really are.
Help us root for each other, to swing for the fences, rather than keep track of mistakes, misses, and mishaps.
Be with all those on our prayer list who are experiencing any heartache, burden, or distress.
Bring them through their grief to meet their experience of your grace and provision.
We pray for those celebrating their birthdays this week, especially Anna, Brogan, Claire, Oliver, Pete, Chris, Melissa, Marianne, Coco, Martha, Karen, Reggie, Steve, AJ, Avery, and all others who this week begin another year of their lives. We also pray for those celebrating the anniversary of their marriage this week.
That you have plenty of grace to go around, that we in turn might have plenty of grace for everyone. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you. All right, come on. You are. We just have so many friends to greet today. It's wonderful. I know. Come on in, have a seat. All right, all of our children are coming back from pageant rehearsal, which is great. All right, if I haven't met you, my name is Miriam, and I work in the church office. And so, on behalf of all of us, we are thrilled to have you with us today. Now, we try to be very intentional as a staff and as a leadership team to really infuse our St. Matthew's values into everything that we do. One of those values is fun. And here at St. Matt's, fun is not just for children, although there's plenty of that to go around. If you haven't yet dove in, Ben, our youth minister, has just an incredibly fun and spiritual program planned for our middle and high school students, including a lock-in, which is coming at the end of December. So I hope that all of our middle and high school kids have that on their calendar. But fun is not just for youth. It's for everybody. So I had to, get ready here. Okay. My friend Avery, did you bring your glasses, Avery? Look, see? Avery has glasses similar to mine, so we'll be taking pictures later. All right, so because we like to have a good time around here, this is very disconcerting, by the way. Okay. On Saturday, December 16th at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, we are going to have a holiday scavenger hunt. So scavenger hunt, holiday race, road rally, but it's going to be in our cars. We're going to go out and see the sights and sounds at around in our community and just have a really good time together. So I encourage you to get your team together. Think of a team name. Get yourself some team t-shirts. Right? I got one of my favorite Christmas t-shirts on today. But get your group together. Register so that we know how many clues to have. The web address to register is right on the front of your bulletin. It's stmatts.org/holidayrace. We're going to get a group together. We're going to go out. We're going to see fun things in our community. And then we're going to come back and have some Christmas treats together. So Saturday, December 16th, I hope that you will be there because you know I will be there and I'd be bringing it, right, with my lights and my, now I just need a team name. So that's what I'm working on. All right. So we will see you then. And now I hope to see you in the parish hall as we all make Advent wreaths today. Thanks so much.
Continue our worship. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and wonderful thing to be able to give God thanks and praise, and so we don't want to miss a single opportunity to do just that.
Holy, 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 God is coming near. Unto us a Savior's born on a midnight clear.
Most good God, we know that you are full of grace, and so you have just filled the world with grace and full of goodness and have intended from the very start that we would experience that goodness each and every day. But Lord, we know that sometimes we lose sight of that goodness and sometimes we don't always feel all that great about ourselves or our life in the world. And so sometimes not being very gracious with ourselves, we're not very gracious with each other either. And so you've called prophets and sages, wise women, wise men, to help us see that you always are gracious with us, that you always believe the best of us, and that you're always willing to help us to be the people that we want to be. But when we still didn't get it, when we still got caught up in ourselves and our own shortcomings and failures, and when we therefore got caught up in everybody else's shortcomings and failures as well, you sent Jesus to show us what a life well lived looked like, to show us how you would have us live life, to remind us of your dream for all humanity. And we remember how Jesus, just in everything he said and did, how he extended to people grace, how he helped them become the people that they wanted to be. We remember how he did that even on the night in which he was betrayed, when instead of being bitter or reacting, how he continued to extend grace by breaking bread, by taking bread, breaking bread, and giving it to his disciples and saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Whenever you do this for the remembrance of me." And remember how he also took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." And so, Father, we do pray you'd send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they be for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, that in receiving them, we'd receive your grace anew into our lives, and that we'd really let that grace permeate our beings and change us so that we can go forth literally from here today to be more gracious in our dealings with one another. And we do ask this all for your love's precious sake. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." The gifts of God for you, the utterly delightful people of God.
Family hiding from the storm, found no place at the keeper's door. It was for this a child was born, to save a world so cold and hollow. The sleeping town they did not know, lying in a manger low. Savior King had no home, has come to heal our sorrows. Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart for God? Shepherds counting sheep at night, do not fear the glory light. You are precious in His sight. God has come to raise the lowly. Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart for God to write His story? You can come as you are, but it may set you apart when you make room in your heart and trade your dreams for His glory. Make room in your heart. Tight. Every wrong will be made right. The road is straight and the burden's light. For in His hands He holds tomorrow. Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart? For God to write His story. You can come as you are, but He may set you apart when you make room in your heart and paint your dreams for His glory. Make room in your heart. Make room.
road is straight and the burden's light. For in his hands he holds tomorrow. Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart for God?
Reminder of our Advent program on Wednesday nights. We had 22 people show up last week, and I hear it was really a very special time. Justin, stand up and so people see who you are. Justin will be leading us this week, so we're really looking forward to it. Even if you weren't there last week, we'd love to have you join us this week, and if you were, hope you'll come again. Let's stand and pray together. Most good and gracious God, thank you for your unending goodness. Especially it is made known to us each and every week in the bread and wine of communion. As we go forth into the world, open our eyes to see every sign of your presence, that we might live in harmony with you this holiday season, and so fill the world with your grace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Life is short, and we have never too much time to gladden the hearts of those who travel this dark journey with us. Oh, make haste to be kind, be swift to love, be sure to extend one another grace. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you this holiday season and always.
That star in the eastern sky, well, it ain't just a star in night. It's a flicker of hope to let the world know that darkness will soon be light. See that stable in a manger low, well, it ain't just a manger, no. It's what heaven used to show me and you just how far his love will go. Make way for the King of Kings. Let heaven and nature sing a song, but it's more than just another song. It's their invitation to all creation. Come see what love has done. Make way for the King of Kings. Let heaven to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. Peace on earth, goodwill to men. Come on. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. Peace on earth, goodwill to men. Make way for the King of Kings. Let heaven and nature sing. A Savior is born today. Make way, make room for the promised one. Emmanuel, God with us. A Savior is born today. Make way, make way for.
To love and serve the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah.